you might say, I've messed up in life and I'm going to clean my life up and try to become more moral and more religious, and then I'll come to God. Listen, don't try to clean your life up and come to God. Come to God and He will clean your life up. You just come as you are. To hear a Bible story, raise your hand. Oh, good, good. I have one for you right now. In fact, the title of my message is Lost Boy, and it's going to be based on a very familiar story in the Bible, the story of the prodigal son. Our life, it's like a movie, and of course, we're the star of our own movie. This movie that we're in, this life that we live, has a beginning, a middle, and an end. A lot of twists and turns, storm clouds and darkness, a lot of things that we don't always understand. And we have questions about this movie we're all in, this life we're all living. Is it a drama? Is it a love story? Maybe it's a comedy. Or is it a hopeless tragedy? A famous cardiologist wrote in his autobiography, quote, "Hope is the medicine I use more than any other. Hope can cure nearly anything," end quote. And I wonder if you're without hope right now, because you cannot survive without hope in your life. It's been said man can live 40 days without food, 3 days without water, 8 minutes without air, but not 1 second without hope. And I have hope for America tonight. I have hope for California tonight. I have hope for you tonight, and it's a relationship with God. I'll tell you where my hope isn't. My hope is not in politicians. My hope is not in technology. My hope is not in mankind at all. In fact, we're living in frightening times right now. Our world leaders are literally talking about the possibility of a nuclear war. Have you noticed? These are scary times that we're living in. We wonder what is going on in this world. We need hope. Generation Z has been described as the hopeless generation. I mean, here's a generation that's the most affluent that has ever lived. They have all the coolest tech. They have iPhones and they have iPads and all this shiny stuff. And I'm talking about their pets, not even them. This is how good they have it, right? But the thing you're looking for is not a shiny object you hold in your hand. It's not anything in particular. The thing that you need that will bring you the hope you were looking for happens in your heart. And I'm going to start by telling you a story about a lost boy. A little boy who had a hard life before him. A little boy that had the cards stacked against him. And that little boy was me. Now, you may think because I'm a preacher, I was raised in a Christian home and I went to Sunday school as a kid, the very opposite was the case. In fact, my childhood was not like the ones that you saw on TV at the time. You know, I thought to myself that maybe things would get better, and I escaped to my little imaginary world of drawing cartoons. My mother, in her day, was beautiful, a Marilyn Monroe look-alike. She loved the attention that was showered on her. Married and divorced 7 times with a lot of boyfriends in between, she would often drag me along to smoke-filled bars as I watched various men try their pathetic pickup lines on my mom. I never knew my biological father. As it turns out, I was conceived out of wedlock, the product of a one-night stand. In many ways, I was the adult in the relationship having to look out for my mom. So after a night of bar hopping, she'd be so intoxicated she could barely walk. So we'd go home and I'd make her a sandwich, but she would usually pass out before it was done. I felt alone in the world. But of the 7 husbands that my mother married, there was one man named Oscar Laurie who adopted me. And that name Laurie has a family motto that means it buds afresh. And the image on the coat of arms as a tree that is cut down but is growing back again. And that was really my life. It was cut down, but it was growing back again. We made our way eventually to Southern California, and I was hoping that my life would get better, but in many ways, it actually ended up worse. I grew up as a young man, and it was the late 60s, and the drug revolution was here in full force, and I thought drugs might have the answer I was searching for. I'd never met an adult I respected. I actually was in rebellion against all adult figures in my life, and the phrase of the day was never trust anyone over 30. That actually resonated with me. We blindly followed the Pied Pipers of our generation that told us to turn on, tune in, and drop out. But soon these musicians that we looked up to all began to die. Janis Joplin, Jimi Hendrix, Jim Morrison of The Doors, Brian Jones of The Stones, ironically, all day died at the age of 27. We were told that drugs would make us more aware, and in a way that was true because I became more aware of how empty I was. One night we drove down to Laguna Beach to buy a kilo of marijuana, not to sell, but to use ourselves. But as we drove back in the rain, our vehicle began to careen and spin out of control. And I thought I was going to die. And I heard a voice saying to me, "You're going to die."
I don't want to die. 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 Hey. I'm dying. I'm going to die.
That's the drugs lying you, man. You're alive. I promise you. What's your name?
Greg. Greg.
It's all right. I'm Lonnie. You ran past my house screaming. I just followed you. Just breathe.
Lonnie, be honest with me, man. You're really here. Are you really here?
Yeah, man, I'm really here. And I'm gonna sit with you here as long as it takes, okay? What are you doing out here? What are you running for?
I don't know.
Hey, where are you going? Greg, God says you don't have to run anymore.
So, that's a scene from my life. But I didn't know where the answer was. I knew the answer was not in drugs. I already found that out from experience. I knew the answer was not in the sometimes affluent lifestyle that my mother lived. So where was the answer? Because as a young man, I was asking the questions, what is the meaning of my life? Why am I here on this earth? Why am I so empty inside? And what's going to happen to me after I die? But here's my question for you. Your life is going by quickly. Are you a happy person? Are you a content person? Or does it seem like if you were a little bit smarter or a little bit better looking or a little bit more successful, then you would suddenly be content? You know, when you're single, you think, oh man, if I was only married, then I know I would be happy. Then you get married and you say, okay. Maybe I married the wrong person. Maybe if I got remarried, I would be happy. So you get remarried. Okay, well, maybe that's not it. Hey, maybe it's kids. I need kids. If we had children, then you have children. And then you're thinking, how do I get rid of these kids? They're 40 and still living at home, you know. It's always just beyond your reach, right? Oh, if I had a lot of money. Money would make me happy, you think. I heard that the Powerball is up to $1.6 billion right now. Can you imagine that? Oh, if I had that, I would be happy, you think. It reminds you of a story of a wealthy employer who once overheard one of his employees say, if I had $1,000, I would be perfectly content. The employer put out his checkbook and said, I'll tell you what, I've never found contentment from my money, but I want to meet a perfectly content person. So he wrote out a check to the person for $1,000 and gave it to them. As he was walking away, the person was overheard to say, why didn't I ask for $2,000? See, that's the way that we are. If I had just a little bit more. Take Anthony Bourdain. He had a very successful television show on CNN. Parts Unknown. He traveled the world, lived a luxurious lifestyle, ate the finest food. He had wealth, he had fame, he had everything, but yet he wrote in a letter to his wife, quote, I hate my fans. I hate being famous. I hate my job. I'm lonely and I'm living in constant uncertainty, end quote. And tragically, Anthony Bourdain took his own life. We think if only I had another life, or if I had another face or body. You know, we put so much emphasis today on the way that we look. $16 billion is spent a year on plastic surgery. And that's in Newport Beach alone. Now when you mention Botox, nobody even raises an eyebrow. These are the jokes, people. I heard about a plastic surgery addict support group that meets weekly. There's a lot of new faces in the group every week, right? All the people who have had Botox are saying, I don't think that's funny. And I can't lower my eyebrows and I don't know what to do. Sorry. It's always just beyond our reach. If I had this, if I had that, then I would be happy. But listen, it's not a thing you're looking for. Here's what you're really looking for deep down inside. You're looking for a relationship with God. There's a God in heaven who loves you. He loves you. Now, some view God as a perpetually uptight, angry, supreme being just waiting to wreak havoc in our life. Nothing can be further from the truth. The God who created you loves you. And has a plan for you that's far better than any plan you've ever dreamed up for yourself. But we think God's angry. God's out to get us. But it's the very opposite. If he's out to get us, it's only to throw his arms around us and tell us how much he loves us. So what is God like? What is God like? Well, I can't think of a better source on that topic than Jesus Christ himself. And Jesus told a story we sometimes call the story of the prodigal son, but it's a beautiful story that always makes sense to pretty much any culture in the world, young or old. Everyone seems to understand this simple story. And Jesus told lots of stories so people could understand what he was talking about. So here's the story Jesus told. Maybe you've never heard it before. He said, a man had two sons. The younger son said to his dad, I want my share of the estate now instead of waiting until you die. So the father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. A few days later, the son packed all of his belongings and took a trip to a distant land, and there he wasted all of his money on wild living. About this time, his money ran out, and a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve. And the boy persuaded a local farmer to feed him the food that was being fed to the pigs, because the boy was so hungry, even the food he was feeding the pigs looked good to him, but no one gave him anything. So as the story begins, we have a boy deciding to run away from home, but really, this is a story Jesus tells that is a picture of us trying to run away from God. Now, it looks like he had a pretty good home, because as we get to the end of the story, we see the father welcome him with open arms. So this was an affectionate home, a loving home. Also wasn't a fluent home, because they had servants. I don't know what kind of home you came from. Maybe you had loving parents, maybe you had no parents. But regardless of whatever home you've come from, I want you to know that you have a Father in heaven who loves you and wants a relationship with you. But apparently this boy thought, you know, I'm tired of dad's rules. I want to live the way that I want to live. And sometimes people say, well, I don't want to live this Christian life. I don't like all these rules that the Bible has. Any rule, so to speak, or principle given to us in Scripture is there for our own protection. You know, we think the worst thing that could happen is to put an animal in a cage. My grandkids used to have a little rabbit. His name was Fuzzy, and they were very little. And they would take him out and play with him in a rather rough way, and Fuzzy didn't like it one bit. And one day I was taking Fuzzy back to his cage, and I came to where the cage was, and he leapt out of my arms to get back into his cage again. Because for Fuzzy, that was not a cage keeping him inside. It was a cage keeping the grandkids out, right? So when I look at God's standards, when he says, you shall not steal, you shall not lie, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not take the name of the Lord in vain, these are standards and truths given for our own protection. And these rules are there to protect us, not to hurt us. But this boy thought, Dad's lame. He doesn't know how to live. I'm going to go live my life. And the father let him go. Listen, God has given you a free will. He won't force his will on you. You don't have to go to heaven if you don't want to. Are you running from God tonight? He longs for a relationship with you. This boy wasted all of his money on wild living. I'm sure he had a lot of friends when he hit town, when he had money, when he had resources, when he had a cool car, or in his case, a cool chariot, or whatever. They thought, oh, we're gonna hang out with this guy. But then when the money was gone, the friends were gone too. Reminds me of a story of two friends that went camping out in the forest, and they were getting up in the morning, having their first cup of coffee. They heard a rustling in the trees, and suddenly they looked, and running toward them at full speed was a very large bear. One of the friends began to put his running shoes on. His buddy said, are you crazy? Do you think you can outrun that bear? He says, I don't need to outrun the bear. I need to outrun you, see. That's how some so-called friends are. They run out when trouble comes. That's what happened to the prodigal. All of his friends left him. He was all alone. And the Bible says, Jesus speaking, he came to his senses. And it's an amazing thing. Listen, there's nothing I can say here tonight that will make you believe in Jesus Christ. But I believe in the power of the gospel. And I know how it changed my life. And I believe there can come a moment where suddenly the lights go on and you just get it, right? You just get it. I used to think Christians were crazy. I made fun of them. I laughed at them. I thought these poor, delusional people. And it was on my high school campus many years ago that I sat down close enough to where the Christians were, because they would have Bible studies on the front lawn. And I sat close enough to hear what they were saying, but not close enough to be seen as one of them. And as I watched them, I thought, these people are so sad. They're so weird. It's so pathetic. And then I thought, yeah, but they're pretty happy, pathetic people. And I happened to know a couple of them personally that I used to party with. And I saw the changes in his life and their life. And then I just tried a new thought on for size. What if it's all true? What if the Christians have this right? What if there really is a God who loves me and I can have a relationship with him? I quickly dismissed it. Let me tell you why I dismissed it. Because I was a cynical young man. because I'd seen things no young boy should ever see in my upbringing with my alcoholic mother and all of her escapades, not to mention my own bad lifestyle choices that I myself had made. I was cynical. I thought it's too good to be true. But then I watched those Christians a little bit more and I thought, well, what if it's true? And then I said, no, it couldn't be true. And then that man who was preaching that day, Lonnie Frisbee, who's portrayed in the film, made a statement that was like a lightning bolt from heaven. He said, Jesus said, you're for me or against me. You're with me or you're opposed to me. I looked around at the Christians and I thought, well, I'm not one of them. Does that mean I'm against God? I don't want to be against God. And then he said, if you want Jesus Christ to come into your life, get up and walk forward right now. And a bunch of kids got up and walked forward. And I thought, there's no way I would ever do that. A moment later, I was up there with those kids praying. And that was the day Christ came into my life. And this can be the night Christ comes into your life. It can happen for you. So this boy finally comes to his senses. Says, you know what, I gotta go home. He realized that everything he was looking for in life was in his father's house. He says, I'm gonna go home to dad, say, Dad, I'm sorry, I've sinned. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Just give me a job as one of your hired servants. And he's repeating this over and over again as he's making his way back home again. Now here's the father, probably sitting on the porch of his ranch house, missing that boy of his, longing for his return. And the father looks down the road and recognizes that familiar silhouette of his boy, bowed down now some with age and perhaps the guilt of sin. And I love how the story ends, because as the boy is making his way home, Jesus says this in Luke 15, while he was still a long ways off, his father saw him with his heart pounding. He ran out, embraced him, and kissed him. The son started his speech. Father, I've sinned against God and I've sinned before you. I don't deserve to be called your son again. But Jesus says the father wasn't listening. He called to the servants, quick, he says, bring out a set of clothes, put the family ring in his finger and sandals on his feet, and get out the grain-fed heifer and roast it. We're gonna have a feast. We're gonna have a wonderful time. My son who was dead is alive again. And they began to have a wonderful time. And then Jesus says, and I say unto you, there is joy in heaven over one sinner that comes to repentance. What a beautiful story this is. Notice that the father welcomed the son as he was. The boy was dirty. The boy smelled like the company he was keeping, which would be pigs. And the father didn't say, well, clean yourself up, boy. I'm downwind of you. You smell horrible. He threw his arms around his son. But what did he do then? He said, give him some new clothes and put a ring in his finger. Listen, you might say, I've messed up in life and I'm going to clean my life up and try to become more moral and more religious and then I'll come to God. Listen, don't try to clean your life up and come to God. Come to God and he will clean your life up. You just come as you are. Say, well, what am I supposed to do? You need to repent of your sin. The Bible says God has commanded people everywhere to repent. What does repent mean? It's a military term. It means to do an about face. So you turn around. Instead of running from God, you run to God. Like the prodigal, he was running from his father. Then he realized that was wrong and he ran back to his father. Repent of your sin. Then you must receive Christ into your life. Being a Christian is not just trying to live by rules and regulations. Being a Christian is not just going to church. Being a Christian is having Christ himself come and take residence in your heart. Does Jesus live in your heart right now? You say, well, I'm not sure. Maybe. Wait, hold on. If a bunch of people moved into your house in the middle of the night and they were like cooking fish at 3 a.m, do you think you would know? I'm not suggesting Jesus is like that. I'm just saying, if someone moved into your home, would you be aware? The answer is yes. So if God Almighty has taken residence in your heart, I think you'll know. And if you can't say I know with certainty, then maybe he hasn't done that yet. The Bible says, for as many as received him, he gave them the power to become sons of God. Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock, and if you'll hear my voice and open the door, I will come in. People, it's not about religion. It's about a relationship with God through Jesus. Maybe God has spoken to your heart and you have seen your need for Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the Son of God who came from heaven to this earth. He was born in a manger. He died on a cross. He rose again from the dead. Why? Because he loves you and he wants a relationship with you. Listen, I'm not talking about religion. I don't want to be a religious person. I don't think you want to be one either. I'm talking about relationship with God. Jesus, who died and rose again, stands at the door of your life and he knocks and he says, if you'll hear his voice and open the door, he will come in. Question, have you asked Jesus Christ to come and live inside of you? You might say, well, I think so, I'm not sure. Hey, if someone moved into your house in the middle of the night, do you think you would be aware of it? I'm sure you would. And in the same way, if Christ has come to live inside of you, you will know. And if you don't know, maybe he has not come in yet. He's just a prayer away. All you need to do is say, Jesus, I want this relationship with you. I want you to forgive me of my sin. I want to go to heaven when I die. Would you like to do that? Would you like Christ to come into your life? If so, why don't you just pray this simple prayer with me? You could pray it out loud or you can pray it in the quietness of your heart. But this is a prayer where you're asking Jesus Christ to be your Savior and Lord. Pray this with me now. Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner, but I know that you're the Savior who died on the cross for my sin and rose again from the dead. Now come into my life. I choose to follow you from this moment forward. Thank you for hearing this prayer and answering this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Did you just pray that prayer with me? If so, I want you to know in the authority of Scripture that Christ himself has come to live inside of you. And let me be the first to say to you, congratulations and welcome to the family of God.